Right, I think we should start. Right, good morning. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, staff members, students. It's indeed an honor for me to start this. I think it's the second last Forward Fridays for the year. The final here one will be definitely on the 26th of April next week. So from our side, I just want to welcome you once again to this wonderful occasion. It's indeed something that Bongani and I came up a few months back after the launch of the Forward Forward exhibition. We thought of how could we, in a way, create something that could form as a catalyst to say more about the Forward Forward exhibition. So he and I came up and coined this idea that we should have a Forward Fridays program. So from our side, although Bongani Mugijima is not here, I just want to welcome you once again. Just a few announcements before I start. Cell phones, ladies and gentlemen, please. It will interfere definitely with the recording. As you can see, this event is live streamed, so it will definitely interfere, so please put it on silent or on vibrate. If you want to use the toilets, it's down with the stairs, up the first door to your left. Men left, ladies to your right. I have already alluded to the fact that we are doing this because we are hoping that it will serve as a catalyst. And I think it did already for debate because people are speaking about and talking about the Forward exhibition and a means of engagement on the future of Stellenbosch University and higher education in Africa. So I'm not going to waste any more time. I'm going to call on our guest speaker, but before he comes on, I just want to say a few words about Dr. Mostert. I hope I'm doing justice to this, Dr. Mostert. Dr. Mostert is the director of the Institute for Futures Research at the Stellenbosch University. He advises globally on futures-based executive decision-making and cognitive development for senior leaders and has worked in places like Paris, London, Dubai, Madrid, Kuala Lumpur, and several African countries. Subsequently, to his PhD in the management of technology and innovation, his areas of specialization include futures thinking, strategic thinking, systems thinking, and creative innovation. Last but not least, he is the chairman of the MediaTek Startup Africa Business Radio. So Dr. Mostert is also a regular keynote speaker and a frequent guest on radio and television in the business media. Without wasting any time, let's give a round warm of applause to Dr. Morne Mostert.
Ricky, thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. The microphone's really for recording purposes. And thank you for that lovely introduction. My mother would have been proud, I think. And for your round of applause, which is odd for us as futurists that you did that before I did anything. We refer to it as an anticipatory round of applause. You're really hoping for the best here. You are a strange audience. You're the sort of person who on a Friday afternoon comes to a museum for a talk. That's an odd crowd to engage with. There are a few options here. One, you find this topic absolutely fascinating. Two, you have nothing better to do. I'll take it either way. I really appreciate the fact that you're here. It's at least a first indication that there's some curiosity on the topic. I direct the Institute for Futures Research, as you heard at the university. We are the first and remain the only such institute on the African continent. And we recently started having a closer look at what the future of the continent might be. And so what I thought I'd share with you this afternoon is how did we come to think about Africa the way we did? You have a certain view when someone says the word Africa, it evokes some things. And if we had more time, we could do a little workshop on what some of those things might be. Does it evoke, for example, stability, peace, welfare for all? Perhaps not. And what I'll do is I'll share with you just some thoughts on how the paradigm of Africa may have come about. And of course, there are many perspectives on this, and this is the wonderful thing about you working at a university, everybody has a view. That's the downside. The upside is you can also express your view. And I'll share some thoughts. So it's a pretty big, crazy place. 54 countries, depending on who's counting. 1.2 billion people, that's quite a few. Over 2,000 languages. Vast percentages of the world's natural resources. Home of the most spectacular civil wars. And a number of other credits. And the strange thing about it is you can say almost anything and the opposite is also true. It's a place of war. Well, look around. It's a place of poverty. Not really. It's a place of uncertainty. You must have a certain future if you're willing to spend your afternoon contemplating matters of these kinds rather than trying to make another buck. So it's a dichotomous, deeply contradictory place, difficult to decode, and that's one of the reasons why so few people try to even talk about it. It's also very sensitive for many people. So let's start with, as I was trained as a Latin student here at the university, with Latin. It all starts with Latin. And this is what the Romans used to say, Semper aliquid novi ex Africa, always something new. Always something new out of Africa. Always something new. And I think it turns out that here in 2019, the words of Pliny the Elder, but even here in 2019, I think we can say the same thing. Always something new. And perhaps you can see this is what I'm going to build my thesis on. The argument that there's enormous potential here, that there's a lot of opportunity here, if perhaps we can just think a little bit about why we think about it in such a way. You heard when Ricky introduced me that my expertise is in thinking. I chose this as a career because that is a lot easier than actually doing anything. You can just think about stuff. But why is thinking so absolutely important? Because everything is the result of thinking. So if you get the thinking wrong, everything that comes after that is a problem. And so thinking about our thinking, what we call meta-thinking or metacognition, is a really important part, and we're applying that this afternoon here to Africa. I was in Finland a few months ago at the Finland Futures Research Institute, and they famously published this in 1989, Africa Beyond Famine. It's by Pentti Malaska, who's the sort of one of the founding fathers of the Finnish futures world. And I love the title because it's kind of challenging us to say, what would Africa look like beyond the most obvious descriptions? So if you say, okay, so Africa's got some famine, what happens after that? And as you'll see later on in the presentation, this was at the end of the 1980s. And you might remember Ethiopia in the 1980s and why famine finds itself on the top, on the front cover of a book on Africa. This is a few kilometers away from here. And it's not exactly where we are today, but it's not very far away. It's a part of Africa, and the part of the tragedy of Africa, when you think about the future of the place, is this picture would have looked very similar if you took it 25 years ago. So let's say we were standing here 25 years ago thinking about the future of Africa. And then we went to the same place today and took the photograph. Well, not much would have changed. So that's a dilemma for us when we try to be Afro-optimists. And by the way, futurists are by their very nature optimistic. You have to be optimistic. You're trying to study a thing that you think is actually going to happen, the future. So you must believe that something else is possible. And so do we in fact firstly believe that something else is possible for Africa, or do we believe, as we very often hear, that it is doomed to be the victim of its own past? One way to think about thinking is that you can try to change the content of your thinking, the level of your thinking, and the method of your thinking. This is, you know, you've made it as an academic if you can divide your field into three sections. You see, I've gone for the three-legged version here. You can also do it in circles if you like. Triangles work well. But you can think about what is it that you think about Africa? Is it at the right level? And what about your method of thinking about Africa? How do you in fact engage with the continent's future? Is it in fact in the content? Is it at the right level? Is it using the right method? And, of course, one of those methodological implications we're all familiar with, so let's get the cliches off the ground and then we can get going, is that the theory is that we are all in this together. The theory is that we're all in this together. It's a difficult thesis to substantiate, given the fact that South Africa is, if not the number one, then among the top three or four most unequal places in the world, and this town in which we find ourselves could certainly compete in the Olympics for the most unequal place on earth. So we're in a very particular place here. And are we in fact in this together? Maybe just one or two things about futures thinking, just one or two thoughts. And that is that futures thinking, unsurprisingly, studies a time yet to come. Now, this seems self-evident, but I can tell you in the work that we've done in the rest of Africa, and I've worked in about 12 African countries, talking about the future is not as easy as you think, because the past has a certain weighting in Africa. One of the reasons for that is the political weight of the past. And many leaders of Africa, in fact, find their legitimacy not from their plans for the future, but their liberation activity in the past. And because that is a source of their great power, that seems to be dominating the rhetoric. You see it in South Africa as well. What we know about the past here seems to be a little bit clearer about what we know about the future, don't you think? And there's a very good reason for that. And so when we talk about the future in Africa, it's a little bit sensitive. It's a little bit sensitive. Because we want to study the future. And of course, if you get your power from the past, you want to discuss the past. So you can see this is a bit of sensitive territory. It's a bit of a dilemma. If you want to study the future, where do you get your data from? And the dilemma is, if you get that data from the past, you're in trouble. Because what you'll then do at best is a little bit of operational efficiency. And you'll want to do a thing that keeps harking back to the past. So for example, in South African, let's apply this to corporate work. Let's get away from the philosophy for a second. South African state-owned enterprises, for example, have been in trouble a number of times. And the kind of the go-to approach is to run a thing called a back-to-basics strategy. You may have come across this thing, a back-to-basics strategy. So the first thing you have to pay attention to is they want to go back. The second thing you have to pay attention to is there apparently is a set of things called the basics. So as scientists, of course, we want to test this assertion. And we ask them, well, if you wouldn't mind, what are the basics, Mr. CEO? And they say, it's obvious. Everybody knows the basics. Then we test this assertion with a very simple experiment. We hand out a piece of paper to the people in the room. We say, ladies and gentlemen, if you wouldn't mind, please record on the piece of paper the basics. Of course, then we get as many views as there are eyebrows in the room. Then the boss gets really upset and gets up and proceeds with the real basics, in his view. So a back-to-basics program doesn't work. There are a few reasons for this. One, there's no consensus on the basics. Two, if the basics were so great, why did they die out? So they've proven themselves to be unresilient. Three, you're trying to ascertain a set of basics that come from a time that's different from today. The real kicker is you're basing your decision on a time that you'll never visit again, and you're doing it for a time you've never visited before. So it's extremely unlikely to be successful. And we've seen this. 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 turnaround strategies in some state-owned enterprises that have all run back to basics strategies. They never got back to those basics because you cannot go back, and even if you could, they won't work. There's a view of what we thought education was. So in this exhibition here on the future of higher education, this is what we thought the future of higher education might look like. Well, at least the French had this view, the turn of the previous century. There's a professor, there always is, humble students, eager to learn. The information is processed through there, downloaded into the minds of the students. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Actually, it would be horrible, wouldn't it? But there's always a laborer somewhere, someone who's underpaid at a lower level. It's not that far away, this idea from Elon Musk's idea, that there'll be a mesh in the base of your brain and you never have to remember anything ever again. Be a remarkable contribution to marital bliss, I would suggest, if you're anything like me. We have a kind of rule of thumb, therefore, for clients about how they spend their intellectual time if you're a senior person. And the rule of thumb, strange expression, rule of thumb, thumb appears to be the only finger with its own rule. You are a very serious bunch of people who have free time on a Friday afternoon, I must tell you. The idea is that that you spend 20% of your intellectual energy on the past. And that's typically the origins of things. Turns out the origins tend to hang around. What's the origin of Africa? And then patterns and habits and customs. They don't die the night after the launch of the new strategy at the Sandton Convention Center with doves and half-naked acrobats. They hang around. They hang around. Then 30% of your intellectual energy on what's going on. At least pay attention to what's going on. What's changing? What's shifting? And we do that in a very particular, what we call transdisciplinary way. And then at least 50% of your energy on what hasn't happened yet. What hasn't happened yet? What could happen? We call those explorative futures. What should happen? We call those normative futures. So, if you think about South Africa, where would you put the scores? I mean, it looks to me like it's something like 80% here, 19% there, and 1% there. You can see it's sensitive territory. Because whatever your focus is, people say, yes, but remember. So it's delicate, delicate terrain. Our relationship with time, it turns out, is not universal as a species. We do a practical example to test this assertion. Let's assume, for example, that you get an email today that you have a meeting on Wednesday. Sorry about that. Get a meeting on Wednesday. Then you get another email informing you that the meeting for Wednesday has now been moved forward by 2 days. On which day is the meeting now? How many of you think it'll be on Friday? How many of you think it'll be on Monday? The rest of you are just not going to this meeting. You just, I don't care, it was confusing. So you can see that there is there is some contradictions in our perception of time, and time perception is not universal for our species, and that makes this little rule of thumb a delicate thing to debate. One of the issues we often discuss with Africa's future is, do we have the skills we need? It just seems to be so close, you can smell it sometimes. But nevertheless, not always achieved. Of course, Africa has an enormously rich intellectual tradition. And perhaps one of the most famous of these is the Museo at Alexandria. This is about 300 BC, a research institute. People like Archimedes and Euclid studied there, this enormous library, this mathematician Aristoteles that managed to measure the Earth's circumference to an accuracy within a few hundred miles and so on. Astonishing scholars in the history of Africa. And you sort of wonder, well, is it still there? Or is it a case of what happened? Let's move on a little bit, if you think that was an aberration, as we say in research. Let's move on about 600 years. The Gears Scrolls of Aksum, the modern-day Ethiopia and Eritrea. The kind of the short version here is it was like the Manhattan of its day. A center of global trade, international trade. I work in the Faculty of Economics and Management Sciences. We're honored to have the dean here, Professor Woolard. And one of the things I like about business is that as much as you can be critical of international trade, one of the things in the minds of people who work in business internationally is they don't have a parochial mindset. Because if you're exposed to all sorts of different people, then you're not xenophobic. You're not threatened. And in fact, you're more curious in the opportunity of the new relationship than you are nervous about the threat this may have for your past. And such a place was Aksum. Let's jump ahead another century or two. We had this guy. This was the selfie of the day. This was the posed today is duck lips. In those days, you raised your hand in a kind of solemn, pseudo-religious way, and you pretend to think about great things while someone draws a picture of you. Anyway, this is this is Augustine of Hippo, and he wrote about two things. This is about that's his life there. This is about 350 odd to 430. That's AD, and he wrote about two things you see on CNN every day today. Rational beings possessing free will. In other words, can we choose? In the West, this is quite a recent discovery in psychology, for example. It's one of the great discoveries in psychology in the last 50 years. Turns out, humans can choose. We didn't know this. In this country, there was no evidence of this before 94. Still the case in some countries in the world. But now we're discovering, turns out, maybe we can choose. We're not destined to have a certain future. And then the second one is just war theory, which he wrote about. In other words, what is a just war? War in Afghanistan, is that a just war? War in Sudan? Somalia, is that a just war? Okay, so there's the early script for Wolf Blitzer. Just to the north of us here, we have the kingdom of Mapungubwe, so-called Hill of Jackals, a vibrant place, city of over 5,000 people, one of the biggest cities of its time, and again, a place that traded, as we would say today, multinationally, an international trade center, if you like. Just to the north of us here, in Zimbabwe. Of course, we know what happened recently, but I do find it really interesting that we have this astonishing, flourishing kingdom just a few kilometers from here, and that is part of our history. So let's think about universities here, since we're talking about the future of higher education in Africa. This, according to UNESCO, is the world's first university. This is in Tunisia. I was there about 2 years ago, maybe. Established in 737, this is 300 years before Bologna. 3 centuries before we had this university. Maybe thinking, gosh, that's just an exception, it's just some crazy folks that wanted to study some stuff that St. Augustine of Hippo wrote. Well, it turns out the second university in the world is also African. This one, Al-Karouin in Morocco. And the third one was also from Africa. This is Al-Azhar University. And this was just sort of on the turn of the previous millennium, Al-Azhar University in Egypt. Then we have the University of Timbuktu in Mali in the 12th century. And in the interim, Bologna has caught on and they've started a university. They don't feature in my presentation. This is Mali in the 12th century. And then it would be another 600 years or so before Africa would get its next university, Fora Bay College in Sierra Leone. So what can we deduce from this little bit of simple reading? This astonishing intellectual history of Africa, place of higher learning, place of higher order thinking, a place that engages with the international environment. A really open, non-xenophobic, non-racial kind of way. I find that really fascinating, don't you? This is where we live. But then, as in all stories, have you noticed all stories have that in there? When suddenly. Well, when suddenly people with skin color like mine got together in Berlin in 1854, in a thing called the Berlin Conference, and they thought, what we'll do is we'll just chop up Africa for ourselves, just among ourselves. We'll just get together, and literally, this is what happened. They had a vague map, not a very accurate one. Google Maps, still not there. And they just decided, you take this piece, you'll take that piece, we'll take that piece. Literally like that. And off they went to conquer the place. Sort of a group of gangsters getting together. You take Constantia, we'll take Rondebosch, that sort of thing. It's really quite bizarre, isn't it? Imagine doing that today. Think, well, here's a place. Doesn't it have people? Yeah, but we're not going to worry about that. Do we understand it? No. Can you speak the language? No. Do you know anything about the local? Nothing. No. How about the ecology? You understand how the rivers flow? No. How about how the tribes move? No. The animals, their migratory patterns? No, nothing. Nothing. All we're going to do is, I'm going to draw a line here, and then this piece is mine and that piece is yours. It's kind of hard to believe that that's what happened, but that's exactly what happened in 1853. Some European companies still do it. They make plans in Berlin and they try to do business in Africa. It doesn't work, by the way. You can't just take your memory stick and plug and play here in Africa and think it's going to work. Didn't work then, and this would change the trajectory of Africa forever, of course. It would be the seed of civil war for decades to come, a century at least of civil war. It would destroy the ecology of Africa. It would start the exploitation of its natural resources. And so Malema sometimes has a point. It's rare, but it does happen. Then about 100 years later, the people of Africa said, wait a second, this is our place, what's going on? So they formed the OAU in 1963 in Addis Ababa in Ethiopia, or Addis Ababa, isn't it, as they prefer to say. And this was, of course, changed its name later on to the AU. And I'm pleased to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that the Institute for Futures Research is now a preferred supplier to the Africa Peer Review Mechanism, which is a group set up to get heads of state to evaluate each other based on their democratic and economic practices. So the AU says, wait a second, the European split is up, why don't we form a unity, the Organization of African Unity? Of course, never in history has there been a worse misnomer. Turns out that just kicked off some civil war, because now there's something on the table to fight for, right? Now we're no longer fighting the Europeans, we're fighting each other. And you can see the benefit of this is we have someone to blame, the Europeans, because don't forget the Berlin Conference. So this would kick off a whole host of civil wars. Let's get into more popular culture a little bit. It's a Friday afternoon after all. Some of you may remember this song. Looking at my demographics here this afternoon, I think some of you may recognize this. For the young people, in the 1980s, there was a little band called Toto, and they did the song, Africa. Never been to Africa, but it was a big thing, talking about Africa. And they wrote this song. And some of the words are things like, you know, I bless the rains down in Africa. I'd love for us to, for a person from Africa, to write a song called I Bless the Sunshine Up in Europe. You think that'd be really cool? Anyway, they were blessing the rains down in Africa. We objected. Of course, it does rain sometimes in Newlands. And we're not down. It's not down. We're not down in Africa. Why are we down? There's no up or down. It just depends on how you look at the planet, right? Okay, so they made millions. They'd never been here, and they had strange hair, even worse than mine. Then, the next year, these guys wanted to feed the world. That's a lovely idea. Feed the world, you know, like animals. Feed them. Yeah. Someone at home ever said to you, I'm going to feed you now? I hope not. Hopefully it's a little bit more of an elegant affair when you meet for culinary purposes. And they asked, do we know it's Christmas? We knew. It was a good sentiment, released in the UK in 1984. And it was a response to the famine in Ethiopia, of course, in the 83 to 85. And this picture became the sort of the logo for Africa. Yeah, these two guys. Okay. Do they know it's Christmas? We want to feed you. Thank you. We do appreciate that. Then they thought, there's a money spinner here, and they did Live Aid. If you haven't yet seen Bohemian Rhapsody, put it on your priority list. Freddie Mercury features very strongly. A guy called Bob Geldof organized at Live Aid, and they raised over £150 million, at least 40%, by the way, of which went to guerrilla warfare because of unsophisticated fund transfers from Europe. That's 1985. You can see what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to get you to think about how much of this has shaped the way you think about where we are versus the stuff I mentioned just before this, right? Okay, let's move on. Out of Africa. My wife loved this movie, had 11 nominations, 7 awards. She's been trying to get me to look like Robert Redford for years. Out of Africa, you know, the tale of the Austrian woman who goes to Africa. I always thought it should be called Inside Africa. I mean, when you go to Europe and go, I'm out of Europe, I'm going into Europe. I know, there's a prepositional problem there, but... yeah, of course, the relationship is tense, and he cheats on her, and time before feminism. And, you know, the background music, you know who did the background music? It wasn't Toto. It was Mozart. He wrote the script, the musical script, well, a few hundred years before. But you can see very European version of Africa. And then Time magazine featured the famine, you know, the wealth nourishing West, the poor Africans. This is, you know, this is art for accountants. Please bear this in mind. It's not this sort of art, that sort of thing. It's kind of quite blatant. But anyway, there they are. This is December 1987. Then, in the same year, this movie, Cry Freedom, won a number of awards. Donald Woods, by the way, wrote this book, Biko, Exposing Police Complicity in His Death. And it's the story, of course, of Biko and the tragedy that led to his death as he was establishing black consciousness in South Africa. This is 1987. Let's jump ahead a few years. The Lion King is another depiction of Africa. The Lion King. What struck me about this is that Africa's a cool place, you know. The animals can sing, lions in the streets. We don't have a care in the world. Everyone walks around singing Hakuna Matata. And so what's interesting to me when I spoke to some colleagues about this is how they kind of really felt that this is the cartoon version, really is the cartoon version of Africa. It's not, it doesn't reflect what actually goes on here. And where is that movie? Because in the previous one, well, maybe that was a little bit closer to the truth. That's The Lion King in 1984. 1995, this one, Cry the Beloved Country. Cry the Beloved Country. This is South African again, of course. Gateway of our paradigm to Africa. And James Earl Jones, who moved on to CNN after that. Yeah, the tale of racism really accentuated. Let's move to other parts in Africa. This is Somalia, Black Hawk Down. I really like this one. It's quite a realistic one. It's the Americans coming in to save Africa, as they do, and it turns out to be a disaster. But not at the box office. Made millions. Won a number of awards. Black Hawk Down, Somalia. I think it's quite realistic, I'd imagine. Then let's move on another year or two to Hotel Rwanda. Remember this one? Yeah. So it's not wrong, right? It's not wrong. It's not true what they're saying. It's just that there's a bit of a theme going on here. And maybe that shapes some of how the world thinks about Africa. And why we... One of the reasons we're particularly interested in this is we're co-hosting a conference later this year with the Club of Rome, leading kind of global think tank on the future of humanity. And we want to give them a sense of how paradigms of Africa may have been shaped, and perhaps I'll show them the same slides as I'm showing you. Save some preparation time. But there's Hotel Rwanda, of course, the brutality, the civil war, and so on. Then we had here on our local shores, Tsotsi. Tsotsi, street language for a gangster. Okay, you detect a bit of a theme here. We hack each other to death with pangas, or we're gangsters. Turns out to be a little bit heartfelt, and the gangster discovers his own sensitive nature and so on. Written, by the way, by the original play written by Athol Fugard, which not a lot of people know is the second most performed playwright in the world after Shakespeare. Okay, that's Tsotsi, did quite well, won Best Foreign Film. Strange nomenclature for us, of course. We don't think it's a foreign film at all. We think that's a foreign film. because it's foreign to us. Then the Black Panther, very recent one. Black Panther, leading Donald Trump to confirm his suspicions that there's a place called Wakanda. And I have to say, I didn't understand this one. So when I spoke to colleagues, black colleagues in the rest of Africa, I was astonished at a recent conference in Nairobi to learn about their view on this. And they were sort of inspired by this. And I thought, I have to admit my ignorance here. I don't understand it. And they were talking about this idea of, Africa represented as technologically advanced and it's possible and we can do it and so on. And I sort of thought, but you're already advanced. You have two PhDs. So why is a movie doing this to you? Like, what's... No one thinks you're not advanced. And I'm just admitting my own ignorance here, which is vast. And I was astonished by how this touched people around the world, people who don't have this kind of skin color. And it made me realize really my own lack of insight and into how deep some of these paradigmatic flaws really are. Okay, that's Wakanda. I know my colleague Andre Roux may have spoken about The Economist, so I'll go through this fairly quickly, the Bible of capitalism. Here's 2000, the hopeless continent. Give up now. Give up now. Just leave. So I did. I went to London. Sorry about that. This is what happens if you spend too much time on an aeroplane. Start doing things like that. Some people become very offended if they see that. If you're offended, I apologize. I was bored. Okay, that's a 14-year-old with an RPG trying to take you out. About 11 years later now, Africa rising. Oh, this is exciting. Something must have happened. We're not just shooting Uzis at people. Or as my son said, that's an RPG. He knows this from the violent games he plays at home. Africa's rising now. Yeah? Here we've got a teenage soldier. Here we've got a young boy with a kite. It's, as I said, art for accountants. Then in a radical display of a lack of lack of creativity, about a year later, Time magazine had the same title. I thought that was really terrible. You see the art for accountants? Africa is the shape in the tree. The sun is rising over Africa. You get it? It's urbanizing in the background. Here's the dust. There's the city. Okay, so Africa's rising in 2012. That's exciting. Then the next year, Africa starts to aspire. This is about the middle class and everybody wants shampoo and toothpaste and stuff like that, and convertibles. This is 2 years later, 3 years later, Making Africa Work. Now it's pragmatic. Now it's pragmatic. Can you see what's happened here? So it's a disaster. Leave for London now. I did. Then Africa rising, so I came back. Then it's still rising, so keep going. Now it's aspiring. The middle class is developing. Now we're making Africa work, much more pragmatic. Fantastic report, by the way, on technology hubs in Africa and so on. Then in 2016, Africa's fragile democracies. Really interesting one. So here we're making it work, but ooh, what's the quality of your democracy? Hang on. Can I take you back just a few years where I was being shot through the head with an RPG? Which problem would you rather have? RPG wound or debate on the quality of your democracy? This is some spectacular progress. This is a spectacular advancement, I'd say. You can see the two sides of Africa, the individuals with their fingerprints. The democracy's delicate like a butterfly. And very recently, just a few weeks ago, the new Scramble for Africa. Bit of a sensitive title, I think. And how Africans could win it, I think that must be deliberate, because in the past Africans didn't win Africa. The West won Africa. I think the new scramble is very delicate. It's there's a debate at the Club of Rome, for example, whether they should talk about the idea of a new enlightenment. So on the one hand, it's very positive. It's a new enlightenment, new version. We're seeing things differently. On the other hand, it's just the enlightenment of the 1600s rebranded. So it's still kind of European-centric. New Scramble for Africa, I took personal offense to that. if I may register my offense, which seems to be a popular hobby in South Africa. There's a new scramble. But I think what they're saying is businesses are charging into Africa. Oh, thanks to the dean, who has more important matters. Okay. Then the Economist published this thing, which shows the scale of Africa. How big is this thing? It's absolutely staggeringly enormous. Some people, again, found this offensive because they thought that this was illustrating the new colonialism by China. It's really just a geographical area indication. Leading our previous president, genius that he was, to suggest that, this is live in front of other humans, that the whole of the world can fit into Africa. Even my 10-year-old son then asked, well, where would Africa go? Let's go to the north, the orange man. It's just evidence of what an advanced country this is. You know, they've now had a white president, a black president, an orange president. It's really quite advanced of theirs. And Trump praises the healthcare system in a place called Namibia. He's very praiseworthy. And he sent that woman as the ambassador. You know, the one that they make jokes about. What's her name? Sarah Palin. Yeah, she's the ambassador to Namibia. Then someone who lives in Namibia created this map. You can see Namibia is over there. And, you know, just so that Trump knows where everything is. And we got Zumba there, Bongola, Tanzania, Utopia. Sue and Dan apparently own those places. I like your booty. That's a cool place. That's a really one. Yeah. Okay, so the question is, I mean, the point is that, you know, do we really know anything about Africa? I mean, if I suddenly said to you, you know, would you be able to pinpoint Benin on the map? Oh, that's just showing off. Okay. Okay, Trump doesn't stop, of course, while he's ahead, so he refers to African leaders and, you know, the kind of the terrible countries that they're from, then denies it, then confirms it, then his staff confirms it, and so on. So the most powerful man in the world has a view on what's going on here. Of course, we have our own reciprocal views. Then David Cameron, if we jump across the pond, refers to Nigeria and a few other countries as spectacularly corrupt. And here I felt really obliged to write something, which the Business Day published. And I said, it's true that there are corrupt places in Africa, but that's not the whole story. There are other places in Africa also. We haven't seen many of those articles. Thanks to the Business Day who published the article. Then I thought, well, is it just politicians? What about the academics? So I went to one of the world's leading universities, Stanford. Maybe I should adjust these slides for this international audience. Went to Stanford, and I found this publication with this title. This is a very recent publication, Ethnicity and Sociopolitical Change in Africa and Other Developing Countries. Yeah. As my son would say, spoiler alert, Africa is not a country. You still hear some of the international airlines telling you that they'll fly to India, Africa, and other countries. To talk a little bit about fashion and you know, the sort of cultural artifacts of Africa. There was this furore about, is it cultural appropriation or appreciation? Louis Vuitton turned the Basutu blanket into expensive fashion items, you know, thousands of rands for some of this clothing based on the Basutu blanket. And this kind of illustrated the dichotomy to me. When you exhibit something about Africa, when is it exploitative and when is it appreciative? And a very big question for a place like this, when is artistic license appropriate? And of course, artists always walk that very fine line. But I did think this was really interesting. So if Louis Vuitton didn't do it, then they have no interest in Africa. If they do it, then they exploit Africa. So what's the way out? What should they have done? Maybe engage with the local people. You know how often that just comes up as an option, which a lot of companies don't think about? What if you spoke to people before? It's just a thought. Just think about it. I love the art examples. Here is another recent one. This is February this year. Gucci had this piece of clothing. You'd think after a while, you know, it's 2019, you'd think they're going to cotton on to this. You'd think an international brand is going to go, okay, no, we're sitting in this meeting in Paris. I've got a plan. Let's design a piece of clothing that makes part of your face black. You'd think someone in the room would then say, I don't know. But it turns out they go, that's a fantastic idea. That's a bloody marvelous idea. We're going to take it through everyone in the business, the whole international value chain. No one thought this might be a thing. Then they launch it, and then the French billionaire who controls it pledge to redouble the luxury fashion brand's cultural sensitivity. This doesn't mean a hell of a lot. If it's zero now, even on my mathematical ability, and you double that. And then there was an enormous backlash. You know, people like Spike Lee boycotts Gucci, and Prada had similar problems over their blackface fashion. I mean, why I'm showing you this is I'm just saying I don't think, despite all of this that I've told you now, I still don't think international companies look at Africa with any appreciation. It's still just from, you know, through a lens that is just unbelievably Western. Here's a good example of how you could make it work. So this is a collaboration between BMW and Esther Mahlangu, happens to rhyme also. And they created this Ndebele car. This is 1991 already. Which I thought was just, this is an interesting example, right? Talk to some local people. You understand what's going on. You see, can we find some sort of connection? And by the way, she also received an honorary doctorate, Esther Mahlangu, from the University of Johannesburg. Stellenbosch should have been in there first, but there you are. Okay, I love that example. I think it's really cool. Didn't really catch on, but it's a clever idea. But now I think Africa is really awakening to this idea of potential unity. So you see this emergence of unity in economic regions, for example. It's not just the philosophy of unity from the 1960s by Nkrumah and others. So economically, it's trying to restructure itself. And this is in March last year. A number of leaders, 44 countries, created the African Continental Free Trade Area, creating one African market, which I think is a game changer. It will change completely the way that trade happens in Africa. Did you know, some of you will recognize that from the back of a Chappies wrapper, for the young people in the room, in the 1980s, there was a snack called a Chappie. It was the Google of its day. Inside the wrapper, it shared wisdom. So here's a Chappie type of piece of wisdom. Did you know, it always started like this, did you know that the total intra-Africa trade as a percentage of the total trade of Africa is only about 16%? In other words, of the total GDP of 54 countries, only 16% is with other African countries. Isn't that crazy? Well, it shows you that colonial trade routes are better established and, of course, still continues. I thought this was an interesting signal, as futurists are always interested in what's the world showing you about this thing you're trying to study. This is from July last year, where India announces that it plans 18 new African embassies. 18 new African... This we have to pay attention to. This is a country with about the same population as our continent. And it will open 18 new embassies. This is a very strong signal if you're a strategist, because it tells you that they want to make sure that China doesn't take everything. They want some of it. They want some of it. Then last year also we had the Beijing Declaration towards an even stronger China-Africa community with a shared future. So China came back fighting. Said, yeah, you may be opening 18 embassies. We see your 18 embassies. We raise you a Beijing Declaration. What do you do about that? Good luck to you. Okay, let's jump back to Trumpville. This is the intellectual giant Melania. She came here after all of this, so obviously wasn't reading the news. And she is dressed in a thing called a pith helmet. Now, I don't know, you remember Out of Africa? This is her full understanding of Africa. She watched Out of Africa. And she thought that what you do is you go to Africa, you get the locals to drive you and to protect you, and then you wear a pith helmet. Now, to wear a pith helmet, I mean, you might as well tattoo "I'm a colonialist" on your forehead. Like, this is, if you wanted to show local people that you think like a mid-19th century colonialist, and you think, what should I wear to show them that? Then this is what you would wear. And to make it worse, you must make it white, so that the dust of Africa will not touch you. Then, and I'm almost done, because I have to run, in November last year, this very important report commissioned by Macron, the French president, the restitution of African cultural heritage towards a new relational ethics. This is for art. I thought it's really important that we have this message in a building like this. We know that France and Britain took a lot of the wealth of art in the history of Africa. It's amazing cultural artistic heritage. And here's the astonishing thing. I mean, if you, and then they put it in a museum. Now, I don't know about you. If I steal your stuff, my first thought is not going to be, how could I display this for others? I would just hide it. But so arrogant are you, if you're a colonial power, that you go to Benin or whatever it is, you steal the stuff, and then to show how well you steal, you put it in a museum. Is it just me? Isn't that odd? So these guys said very much what Malema did, pay back the money or give back the art. And then Macron said, okay, we will give back 26 objects, bearing in mind that there are at least 90,000 of these. Yeah, it's a bit like you steal someone's car, they catch you out, and you go, I'll give you this tissue box which was in the back seat. Is that okay? You're happy with that? Okay, I'm glad we could sort this out. And then the British Museum, they will also return some Benin bronzes, and they put some conditions, and the conditions included, have you got a decent place to store it? This is like you steal someone's car, you get caught out, and you say, I will return certain parts of this car, provided you can prove you have a decent garage. Is it just me? And then all hell broke loose. France is now giving back 26 artifacts. So now they're like any white male over 70, you know. They were a fighter against apartheid. Have you noticed this? You cannot find a white male in South Africa who was over 70 who was not an anti-apartheid activist. I find that quite amazing. Anyway, now France is giving back 26 of 90,000, so now they are saying to the rest of the world, including Italy, you got to lift your game. Look what we're doing. You got to lift your game when it comes to Africa. Ladies and gentlemen, Africa's population is exploding in its youth and will be one of its great opportunities. But I had just a few moments with you to share how our paradigms of Africa may have developed. Of course, we lack the time to go through all of those. We did develop, if you're interested, a set of scenarios for the future of South Africa in Africa called the Madrid Scenarios. We thought we'd be colonial and name it after a European city. No, we did that because it was launched in Madrid. And my time has unfortunately come to an end, but I thought I'd just share with you this afternoon some of the possible reasons of why we think we're the way we do about Africa. Of course, what we should do next is to think about what does the future look like for Africa, and is going back to basics really the way to do it? I want to thank you for your kind attention, and I'll leave you, as I often do, with the words of the Hollywood comedian George Burns, who said, "I look to the future because that's where I'm going to spend rather a large part of the rest of my life." You've been lovely. Thank you very much. By the way, you can go onto our Facebook page, Institute for Futures Research on Facebook, and the Twitter handle is IFR, at IFR Africa. Thanks, Ricky.
Right, thank you very much, Dr. Mostert, for that insightful talk. We were planning to have some questions, but unfortunately, are we going to allow one or two? Okay, let's see. One or two questions, then we can end this off.
My name is Dr. Jean Miller. What I'm surprised about is that you don't mention some of the hot technologies that are taking place in Africa: mobile communications, mobile banking, the whole, I mean, there are hot areas which are moving. And the other thing with taking people's properties, if you look at Europe and the world, Moscow or Russia has the best collection of Chinese porcelain, and Russia has the best collection of Impressionist paintings. I mean, and whatever, Germany of Greece, of ancient Greece, sort of. I think once you start handing everything back, and also for Greek ruins, they would actually be rubble if they hadn't been preserved, and there are lots of cases of that. So that's the main thing, and I'm surprised for futurology. And also, one of my colleagues in Brussels worked for the Pestel Foundation, you know, the Club of Rome, and still does. Okay. But I'm surprised there wasn't more about your optimistic version.
Yes, you're quite right. You're quite right. It's very interesting that we do a lot of work on the future of the continent. In fact, Dr. Mwagiru, sitting just behind you there, leads that project. And please do talk to us about your needs there. If you want to discuss that further, we're happy to do another session here, Ricky, if that's what people are hoping for. I think for this afternoon, we wanted to consider the idea of how we got to the way we think about it. And kind of make sense of where it is. But I agree with you in the sense that I'd much rather have a sort of workshop and look at scenarios for where it's going. But what we find is that if people haven't kind of made peace with why they think the way they do, they struggle to think about where it could be going because they simply copy and paste the past. And what we often find is that if you processed it a little bit, then people are a little bit open to think about what are some of the alternatives. But it's an absolute fair criticism. If you're a futurist, talk about the future. Fair enough.
I have a question to you, the speaker, about kind of centralizing, you know, if it's possible, you know, would it, a simple question to ask you, could you centralize maybe your talk more on the Khoisan, because I have a little bit of knowledge about the Khoisan here in South Africa here, and I know that they do believe very much in looking to the future in using the futuristic, the so-called kind of cosmology, and reading the stars in terms of where to go in life and how to look ahead and things like that, you know, to sort of ground yourself in that, because it's these South Africans, Institute for Futures Research. Thank you.
We do in our academic program, just for interest, engage with the idea of shamanism and its role in contemplation of possible futures. And of course, I don't think there's enough study done on this. We know from some of the very traditional African cultures that there are all sorts of perceptions about the future. And one of the things we're really interested in is the role of ancestors as it relates to the future. And it's, for some people, a little bit of a contradictory idea, because ancestors appear to be about the past, but of course it turns out they play a role in the future too. I think one of the things that's an opportunity for us, which I think you've highlighted, is to explore some of the traditional methodologies of conceptions of the future, and to think about how, if at all, they may find some sort of grounding in the Western perspective. One of the things we are working on is African conceptions of time, if that's even possible to think about. But I spoke about this idea of the weight of the past in many African environments. But of course, you're right. There's a richness in the whole of Africa, which is, and its diversity is also such that, you know, if you just look at tribes across Africa, I mean, what would you say? How many tribes have we got? Maybe 800 at least, if not 1,000. And each one of those, you know, would have a, you know, sometimes a sort of unique accent on how they think about planning, longer term engagement with the planet, the relationship with their forefathers and their children, and so on. So you're right, there's a lot of richness in the cultural heritage of Africa. You can see that this can really be a lovely debate, and it would be a really, really interesting discussion. We've really kind of just scratched a little bit of the surface with a few slides. I am deeply grateful, though, that you managed to fob off all the other important things that you had to do this afternoon and came here for a little chat. Do stay in touch with us. We're very happy to engage with you. Thank you. Ricky, I think we'll close there. Ricky, I'll hand back to you. By the way, are you going to brag about this book? Okay. Available now in all good bookstores is this publication called Forward. The museum commissioned 100 art pieces on the future of higher education, and some of them are exhibited here. And the Institute for Futures Research then produced the text on explorations of the future of higher education in Africa. I was privileged to edit it. Please buy now for Christmas, I think is the advice, Ricky. And it's available here at the museum at Protea Books, which is in the future. Okay. You can also contact us. We can put you in touch if you'd like to have a look at it. It's got some great stuff in there. Okay, now I'm really going to stop, Ricky.
Right. Thank you very much, Dr. Moster, for that. And from our side and from Bongani's side, thank you very much, sir, for blessing this occasion. And from our side, you can come and enjoy some refreshments at the back. Thank you once again.